Dear members, yesterday we believed one of every member had a wonderful session. I hope got a good knowledge on the company's director's report. As acceptance of deposit by companies, loans to directors and non-cash transaction, that is today. Dear members, yesterday our beloved Central Council member, Prasanna Kumar sir, explained so many things about this coming MEF and that RBI notifications regarding especially for the category 4. Category 4, we explained that if any, the means the proprietor concern who having the that means that two not having two partners, it might be is ineligible as per the RBI notification. OMSI will share that notification so that every member will get the good knowledge. OMSI, I don't think it is not sharing.
No, sir, I have already shared in updated ICAI Nellore group, sir. If you want me to share in Nellore CS, I will share there.
No. Now I can explain that notification.
Okay.
Can you share that?
You want me to share it on the screen, sir?
Yes.
One second, sir.
So that every member will get the good knowledge on that. What is the impact is going on? Because yesterday, few of the members could not able to join that initial because of the first time the Nellore branch using the Zoom platform, so everybody could not get that link. So that again I will explain because at all the district level or in the cities level, most of the practice members are proprietary concern and that category 4 firms.
Sir, can I interrupt? I have to leave at 11:30. So if it is taking a long time, probably you could do the presentation a little. I'm just taking that extra freedom to ask you.
Yes, but
so
please
you
continue.
Can give a brief intro and then the presentation can follow.
Sure.
Because I have to leave at 11:30. I'm extremely sorry for this.
No problem.
It's very important. I think you should continue to discuss after I leave. Thank you so much for the understanding.
Yes, please go ahead.
Thank you, sir. I request Mr. Lakshmi Prasanna garu to please introduce our chief guest to our audience.
Good morning. He is a fellow member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India with 28 years of diversified practice experience. He is a chairman of Southern India Regional Council of CA Institute in 2019-20. He is the founder and managing partner of JVR and Associates, an 8th partner firm specializing in corporate audits and consultancy. His mentor, Philip M.C. Millan Woods, a multidisciplinary accounting and consulting firm based in Dubai. His faculty for auditing at the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, he taught more than 10,000 CA students. He is regular resource person on professional circuit on accounting and auditing standards and corporate audit. He has done more than 800 presentations, also a peer review trainer. He was member of the auditing and assurance standard boards of ICAI. He was chairman of ICAI Ernakulam in 2002-2003, in UK, Middle East and Far East. He is past president of Rotary Cochin Central and member of various social clubs. He is honorable treasurer of Kerala Management Association. He is a member advisory board of ST Teresa's College, Ernakulam. Thank you, sir. Thank you for accepting as a chief guest.
George, sir, you can proceed with your speech.
Thank you. Good morning to all of you. The very dynamic chairman of the Nellore branch, CA Vamsi Krishna, Secretary Arun Kumar, your ex officio member, and my very dear friend, my younger brother from Hyderabad, Chinnamma San, who will be assuming a very important position in SIRC next year. He has taken a back seat this year, preparing for a major comeback next year. We are all working on that. Other managing committee members, particularly Lakshmi Prasanna, the immediate past chairperson of the branch, to whom I owe an apology. Lakshmi, thank you for the nice introduction. I owe an apology because last year, though I was frequenting Chennai, two times she had invited me to the branch. I could not make it. I have not come to Nellore at all. I have come up to Tada, where I had a client. It's an industrial area, right? Where I had a client, where Reebok and all that there. So Nellore, I would like to visit post-COVID at the earliest possible time, before probably Vamsi lays down his office in the company of Thinnamus. And I'm also seeing a lot of familiar faces, including Mr. Subbarao. And he has stopped sending mails. Sir, your mails are very informative. Please continue to do the good work. The dissemination of knowledge is something which is very, very relevant at this point of time, particularly when we are not able to get together in large numbers because of the COVID and all that. At the outset, my compliments to the branch for organizing this two-day program. Extremely happy that you had Jagmohan Rao, sir, who is a former SAFA president, and the chief guest was Prasanna Garu. Prasanna is traveling across the place. I mean, now interacting with all the branches. Pre-COVID, he was traveling extensively, very active central council member, and I worked under him. My first year in the council was under his chairmanship. A very nice person. So, and Jagmohan Rao, I'm sure that he would have given a lot of insights on director's report. Though it is the management's domain, most of the time in private limited companies and smaller unlisted companies, we help the management to draft the director's report. So those contents are very, very important. And today we are deliberating on the deposits and loans taken by companies covered under Chapter 5 of the Companies Act 2013. We have a very, very learned speaker, as I understand, Madam Meenakshi Jayaraman. I am welcome on behalf of the branch also. I am part of every branch of SARC. And last year I had an Andhra tour and we visited six branches in a row. And Monday I am addressing Kadapa, Karnool and Anandpur branches on standards and auditing and COVID pronouncements. So looking forward to a nice presentation, but I may have to sign off in between because 11:30 I have another assignment. I'm in my hometown, which is 65 kilometers down south from Cochin, where I live and work. I come down here. We had some heavy rains here. We still have. And Nellore also, we read in earlier days, Nellore was the first place where the cyclone used to hit. And then it used to come to Chennai. I did my articles in Chennai way back from 88 to 91. Ma'am, you are from Chennai? Meenakshi, ma'am? Oh, so nice.
Very, very much part of Chennai.
All Chennais are my brothers and sisters.
Thank you so much.
So nice.
Nice to hear that.
Yeah.
We live in Chennai, actually. Very safe place to be here.
Yeah. I always say that if I have a second house, that will be in Chennai. And I still remember the days, Ilayaraja songs and Chennai.
Wow.
Those were the best days of my life. So I had a great
That sets a great mood for this entire session, sir. And a warm welcome to you to our office and to our home as well.
Sure. I'll surely come. So that is about today's deliberation. Very important. Chapter 5 is a very important chapter. Very casually taken by management because borrowings, particularly in Kerala, Andhra Pradesh and all that, we have this little bit of too much of a cash culture. That's very dangerous. That is 269 SS of the Income Tax Act, which is not the discussion today. Under the Companies Act also, if you look at Chapter 5, I think it's the most punitive. The penalties run into lakhs of rupees, crores of rupees and plus, if madam will tell us that 6 months of free food and accommodation, am I right? Or with both.
Imprisonment, right, yeah.
Imprisonment for 6 months or with both. So we'll let us look forward to that. I'm not getting topical here. Thinnamasan specifically asked me to speak about a little bit about the COVID lessons and how we should gear up to learn to work from home or work away from office. I think COVID lessons quickly, if I may say, I think when the lockdown was declared, we are 8 partners, 5 of us sit in Cochin. And we had a meeting and we asked ourselves, do we have the reserves to pull on for 2 to 3 months if the lockdown continues? Luckily, we had, of course, there were some reserves. So my first suggestion is that, not that another COVID is going to come, but then in our professional and personal sphere of activities, I think we should have sufficient reserves to fall back upon in this kind of very unprecedented pandemic or anything that would disrupt our regular routine and work. So we have. Yes.
Can you keep that mic? Its voice is coming very little low, the sound.
Oh, really? Okay. I would be louder now.
No, keep like this. Then you will get the good sound.
Okay. Am I audible now? Better?
Yes, perfectly. Now it's a double sound.
Okay. Thank you, Chinna. I was a little unmindful about it. Thank you so much. Okay. So the second question was the receivables. I always say that chartered accountant is the only industry which gives 12 months free credit. So if you had huge receivables on 23rd March, then we had a problem. Then the going was good. We did not collect. So how do we ask our people who are in trouble? Kerala, we have a lot of tourism industry. So they have zero revenues for the last 3 to 4 months. So very difficult. So promptly billing and collecting is something which we should do. This is one another lesson. The third one is most important. These are about being resourceful and being not having huge receivables. The technology that I've always been advocating on improving the infrastructure and the technology we should have. So when this lockdown happened, we were all scared. How do we access information, including some personal information? Some of us have it in the laptop, but mostly it's in the server. So how do we access a server? So I'll share our experience, which I think has been reasonably effective and successful, where we have some space, server space on the cloud. I hope you are also using the iDrive, where we have a backup to the, we have access to the back office or the backup of the server, the real server, the physical server. And then with that, we started accessing on the backup. And then for real-time access, post-COVID, when the lockdown, when we reopened, we also enabled the VPN. And with that, the partners have now access to the real-time access to the server data. So it's very important that we have uninterrupted access. One concern here is that of data security. Data security, where a lot of new thinking or new technologies are evolving. But then even with that, today the only way is to, and also to selective students with a renewed oath of confidentiality, I think we should share the information. That's the only way we can work. So since Sinha wanted me to say, this is the way we work, and we have been reasonably successful, effectively, and we are able to allot work to the students who are sitting at various parts of the state, and that is how we are working. So that's briefly on the technology which we have leveraged on. I think there's much more to be done. Today, how fast and how far we go ahead in our profession depends on how well leveraged we are on the technology. This is very simple things. I'm not a tech person. I'm fortunate to have a young partner who is very tech savvy. He's looking into these aspects. This is my macro understanding of how it is. And if there are specifics, I think always, as Sinha suggested, we should have a techie on board, and we can have more meetings on this to gear up for the, and this is technically, I think, is called a hybrid server kind of situation. So I think this is something which we should do. One more thing Chinnamasan wanted me to talk about is the signing of provisional and projected financial statements by chartered accountants. This is quite rampant, but unfortunately, because a local branch manager of a bank wants every sheet of paper given to him to be signed by a chartered accountant with a seal, we are getting inclined to that. This is very, very dangerous. The profession is under the lens, under surveillance than ever before. While we are deliberating here, I'm sure all of you are aware that the NFRA in the Companies Act sphere or company audit sphere, NFRA has slashed huge penalties on one former partner and two partners of Deloitte Huskins and Sells for the IL&FS, the debacle where 92,000 crores of irregularities were detected. The NFRA very specifically and emphatically said that the auditors did not exercise due care and diligence and were very passive in discharging their responsibilities. The penalties run from 5 lakhs to 25 lakhs and a total ban of 7 years from doing any audit or internal audit. In the tax audit sphere also, in smaller towns like Cochin and Nellore, we do not have many large corporate audits. But in tax audit sphere also, the QRB, the Tax Audit Quality Review Board. So we are under the lens than ever before. We cannot be very passive. We should gear up on developing domain knowledge and then really applying it. The problem here is that we are yielding too much to the client's demands. We are thinking more about the client than the profession. We are thinking more about the client than the regulators. So the answer is naturally yes, sir, because he is the one who's paying us. Paying is different, but paying doesn't mean that we are going to sign every paper. So recently there was an article by our dear friend, Mohan R. Levy, half-page article in the Business Line, where he said that the auditors were using the decision in Kingston Cotton Mills case, which was delivered in 1896 by learned Judge Lopez, where he said that the auditor is only a watchdog, not a bloodhound. I heard Amarjit Chopra sir saying, not just a watchdog, at least be a barking dog. And we are given a whistle, we are whistleblowers, and if you don't blow the whistle, we know that a lot of people are waiting to take away the whistle. The regulator, the other sister kind of professions, which might take away. So therefore, there are concerns which we need to understand and be gearing up and leaving beyond. So we have to endure the situation. Now coming to the provisional financial statements. I'll give this example. We have a client, you and I have a client, a partnership firm with 80 lakhs of turnover. What kind of a client is this? Is he an audit client? It's not an audit client because there's no audit requirement. It's not a company. It's not a partnership firm, not tax audit, unless it's a 44 AD, 44. I moved away from tax practice long back. Past 7 years, I've not gone to an income tax office. Specialization is the key. Gone are the days where everyone will do everything. Specialize have to emerge. You don't have to be a jack of all trades, but you have to be a master of at least one. So we need to have larger firms. When you are a sole proprietor, you can't. You have to do everything. So therefore, larger firms have to be formed. Like-minded firms people have to come together. Back to this. So this is not an audit client. So here, if you refer SRS 4410, SRS is Standard on Related Services, SRS 4410, which very clearly says that we should not sign provisional financial statements. I've also seen chartered account signing subject to audit, put the seal and sign. The only way we can sign a provisional financial statements is by saying refer compilation report. Even auditors, any term like audit should not be given in the financial statements. Here, technically speaking, the client is approaching us seeking accounting expertise to prepare sensible financial statements. One, to file his tax return annually. Two is to give to the banker where we have a facility of ODCC or something like that, or for an expansion proposal. Here we have to be very careful. So subject to audit provisional financial statements, just putting the seal and signing is prohibited. I repeat, it is prohibited. Please refer SRS 4410, which tells us how to deal with the situation. And to the extent possible, what we have done is in such cases, what if we do not sign? The bank manager has to be educated. Today when Udin came, we are the institute is sensitizing the end users, IBA, the Reserve Bank, the CBDT, the CBIC, whoever, saying that a chartered account signature without an Udin is invalid. It should not be relied upon because there is no ownership. There is no parentage. There is no fatherhood, I would say, one step ahead. So this is something which one has to be extremely careful. So SRS 4410 throws light on that. I would be only happy to send you a detailed note on this since I'm not able to do a PowerPoint presentation here. Another thing is that the managers would also ask, typically a client would ask, sir, we are looking for an enhancement of the ODCC. So manager has asked for audited last year, which we have audited or what were provisional and provisional this year. Provisional this year and 2 years projection. And the last statement is a dangerous statement. Everything to be signed by user. And we readily do that. And we land up in trouble. Today, if there are 12 lakh crores officially, unofficially they say it's much more, 14 trillion of bad loans in the Indian banking system. Not my version. Amarjit Chopra sir was asking, can we disown? We have been passive in certifying statements which are not really giving the right picture. Large crores and crores of non-existent stocks sitting in the balance sheets of many corporates. And we are not talking about Vijay Malaya or Choksi or something like that. In smaller cases, all of us in our own way sometimes help clients. This has to be stopped. Otherwise, we are going to be in trouble. NFR is going to really, really flex its muscle on the profession and we are going to take a beating. Now, projected financial statements. Please refer SAE 3400, Standard on Assurance Engagement 3400, which is captioned as Examination of Prospective Financial Information. Examination of Prospective Financial Information. And there, to the extent possible, you convince the manager that projected cannot be signed because a lot of premises on it. It is based on the management's business plan that we do a projection. An Excel working being done by us, as long as we do not own and sign it up, it is helping the client. The moment you sign, the whole thing changes, the scene changes. Therefore, very, very important that we do not, and SAE 3400, if you read, it is primarily washing your hands, saying that we have broadly reviewed the financial projections made by the management of the company. Though we prepare it, we give it that way. And we do not see anything too inconsistent to believe that, you know, there will be material deviation based on the n number of premises or assumptions on which the financial projections have been prepared. So these are the two things which I thought I should highlight as a special request, I would say request. Chinna sometimes give directions to which you cannot say no. And so these are the things which are very important. Extremely happy that we could align. And chairman is a happy man. Just 2 minutes back, he hit a half century. So hopefully going forward, as Meenakshi ma'am takes over, you would be at the crease like Virat Kohli, hitting fours and sixes and reach a century soon. Wish you all the very best. Great effort by the Nellore branch. My promise that before the moment COVID settles, Chinna, you have to take care of that. The COVID settles down. And once again, my apologies to the immediate past chairperson, Lakshmi Prasanna, for not being come there last year. We'll continue to discuss, and professional interactions have to happen. And today, technology has enabled us. Though we can see each other, we are sitting in different places. I'm in a place very close to Sabarimala. Some of you would have come there. My hometown is just 40 kilometers from Sabarimala, Pamba, Erimeli, and all that. So you are all in Nellore. Some of you may be a little away. Extremely happy. And once again, my sincere compliments to the branch for putting all these elements together, making this wonderful event happen. And two very, very prominent, eminent speakers. And once again, looking forward to meeting you all at the earliest possible time. Let us stay tuned. Three things are very, very important in this COVID scenario. One is restraint. We are sitting virtually meeting, avoid unnecessary travel, going to crowded places, whether it's a marriage function or a funeral, social distancing, all that. So one is restraint. At the same time, resilience is more important. We should have the resilience to, you know, move forward and sail through. And most important is a fresh resolve. They're having the optimism that there is light at the end of the tunnel. The vaccine would hopefully soon be out, and then with that, this will become COVID become like another fever and headache. That is a pleasant optimism all of us should carry, and all the clients comfortable, and do not yield to the clients' unnecessary demands. Only then that the first generation auditors were pundits. Today, some of us, unfortunately, they have been reducing to a clerical level, particularly with GST and all that. Lot more things to discuss, as time is more important to listen to Meenakshi ma'am, and I have to sign off. I think I've kept my time 11:30. Chinna, sorry for that slight
interruption. No problem.
Please do this MEF and bank audit is something I know we're very passionate about and very important for members, sole proprietors, beginners. I'm very much with you on that. So with that, I conclude wishing you all the very best. Jai ICA, Jai Hind. God bless everyone. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Joman.
Thank you so much
for giving. Coming and giving wonderful address.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful speech. You have clarified many of our members' doubts, including our Vice Chairman, Mr. Sujit Kumar Jain. In many occasions, he has raised a question saying that whether we can sign the projection. So rightly, you have addressed the issue to all of our Nellore branch members, sir. Thank you very much. Now I request... Mr. Sujit Kumar, now I request our Chinnamasthane garu to please continue with his session. I will upload the PPT. One second.
Yes,
sir.
With your permission, I'm leaving the meeting.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you for joining.
Sujit, I think you can mute your mic. Yeah. Thank you.
Madam, with your permission, I will take less than 2 minutes. That's it. No, I will close that. Okay. Umsi, can you scroll down to category 4, that notification, the next page. Yes. Yes. No, go up. No. Down. Category 4, come to that. Next. Members, you see that category 4, even proprietary concern without bank audit experience may be considered as therein here too. Next page, please. The proprietary concern of the chartered accountant with one paid CA. This is the exact point. this every proprietor concerned must have the one paid CA and the proprietor, then only category 4. This notification issued, I think, in the 2016, this notification. Till now, the MEF software not updated this condition. So now the RBI is specifically saying it should be include this condition in MEF software. If this condition implemented, the out of 22,000 firms, so no firm will get that category 4. But this condition existing from the last 4 or 5 years onwards. So RBI is silent and the institute is silent. But this is that in specific, in advance, the RBI requesting to keep this. And my knowledge, institute is discussing with RBI. Might be it is postponed for this year, but next year it definitely will come to the picture again. So otherwise the notification will be modified. So the issue is, again, this the one paid CA must have, you, as on the date of 31st December 2019, not the current date. So for the bank audit March 21, you should have the database of 31st December 2019. 31st. So now it's not possible to add as a paid CA also. So this is the institute also having this problem, may not be possible to implement. But this December, coming 20 December, it will impact 22 March. I request you all, so comply this condition for the get the category 4 audits or to get the category 4, or otherwise you make a without fail as a partnership firm, at least 2 partners. That is the impact of the specific notification. I hope that everybody has understood this one. This is the, because yesterday also the Prasan Kumar sir explained this one, but few of them could not join. Again, I explained. We have the some other points we'll discuss later, because I'm an exception, I can join anytime. So, Omsi, this my end of my speech.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your beautiful presentation regarding the RBI notification, which was come 4 years back. Now I request our Vice Chairman, Mr. Sujit Kumar Jain, to please introduce our faculty, Meenakshi Jayaraman Garu, to the audience.
Meenakshi Jayaraman Garu is a graduate in Commerce and Law. He is a qualified company secretary and associate member of the Institute of Cost Accountants of India. She heads the corporate law and secretarial practice at DVS Advisors LLP. Has nearly 2 decades of rich experience in areas of secretarial, corporate compliance, legal and finance. She started her corporate career in Indian Express as an assistant company secretary to handle secretarial activities of all group companies. In Cognizant Technology Solutions, she had work experience in area of secretarial, legal, taxation and finance. She was a company secretary and manager finance in TVS Infotech. She headed the secretarial function in Fox Mandel, a law firm. She has exposure to listed entities and NBFC compliances during her association with Chola, a part of Murugappa Group, as assistant vice president, and Hinduja Leyland Finance as company secretary. Her core areas of specialization include corporate law, allied legal solutions with special focus on mergers, demergers and restructuring. She is an active researcher and has presented numerous technical papers across various forums, colleges and institutes on the subjects of company law, FEMA and allied laws. With this, I present our speaker, Meenakshi Jayaraman Garu.
Thank you, Sujit. Sir, Chinnamastan, sir, your mic is on. Chinnamastan, sir, your mic is on. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Sujit. Now I welcome Meenakshi Jayaraman Garu for this seminar, and I request the madam to please address the gathering. Ma'am, you can share the screen now.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sujit, for the detailed profile. Thank you so much. So, Vamsi, shall we start?
Yes, ma'am, we can start.
Good morning, all my fellow professionals. Before we begin this, my sincere thanks to Mr. Subba Rao for inviting me and making me a part of this August gathering. And my sincere thanks to Mr. Vamsi Krishna for coordinating and getting this organized extremely well and making this, facilitating me in doing this with ease. And my sincere thanks to all the fellow professionals, office bearers, past chairman, chief guest, and the current chairman of the institute. A very good day to all of you. And it will be an interactive session, friends. So you can stop me as and when there is any kind of clarification or anything that you would like to share with regard to that respective slide, or we can have it in the fag end of the session. Today, we are going to discuss about three important topics under Companies Act. So we will be classifying it into three segments. One, prohibition and restriction on acceptance of deposits, chapter 5, as rightly mentioned by our chief guest today. Then we are going to talk about loans to directors, section 185 of Companies Act 2013. Segment 3, we are going to touch upon non-cash transactions, a brief provision introduced under Companies Act, a new concept which was not there under Companies Act 1956. So the structure of today's presentation for the benefit of the August gathering will be under four folds. One, we are going to discuss about the background of each section. Why we have a section? Because for any act, we have a preamble. We understand the rationale as to why we have that particular provision, so that we can appreciate the relevance of that particular provision and the sensitivity behind the compliance and the audit reporting in the event of non-compliance. And in the second fold, we are going to talk about the provision, which you all, I'm sure, would be aware, but it will be a quick recap. And I assure you that it will not be a replica of the section, but we are going to discuss more from the analytical perspective of the section. Fold three will be a case study, a judicial precedent on the subject. And we will conclude with an illustration so that we can understand it from a practical perspective and appreciate the provisions. So with this brief introduction, let's get into today's presentation, professionals. These are various legends used in today's presentation. I'm sure most of the references we all will be aware, but while using the presentation, I'm sure Mr. Vamsi would have shared the presentation with all of you, so you can use it for your future reference. Predominantly, we'll be using CAD reference, where CAD is the company's acceptance of deposit rules, friends. This is agenda for today's presentation, where we will be talking more about the prohibition on acceptance of deposits, various terms and conditions, be it specific conditions or general conditions as imposed in section 73, 76, read with relevant rules. Various deposit limits as imposed for various categories of companies under the section and the relevant rules, be it for private company, specified IFSC public company, government company, or eligible company. We will also see which are those eligible companies which can accept deposits from public. Of course, there is relaxation under Chapter 5 as well, like any other provision. So we will see what are the relaxations and which are those companies where this particular relaxation is available. Deposits from public. Section 76 of the Companies Act, where you have the provision for accepting or inviting deposits from public over and above the deposits which you accept from members, and several other provisions under CAD rules, which are important in the light of the relevant sections. We will be looking at two important case laws on the subject. Then segment two, loans to directors with the restrictions and relaxation. Restriction on loans and the relaxation in advancing loans granted pursuant to Companies Amendment Act 2017, thankfully, and a case law on the subject. Segment 3, we will talk about restriction on non-cash transactions. We will see the relevant meanings of certain terms which we are going to use under all the three segments for the benefit of our reading and understanding. The procedural requirements. Though section 192 is fairly a simple provision, it is not left with a simple procedural aspect. You have to comply with the norm, otherwise the CARO reporting will give an observation and or an audit remark on the subject. So we will see how the CARO reporting touches upon this section 192 compliance. First segment, acceptance of deposits. Some of the terms, key terms, there are several terms used under the section and rule 2 of companies acceptance of deposit rules, but today predominantly we will be using the term deposit. It is imperative for us to understand the term deposit, friends. So deposit under Companies Act 2013 assumes a wider provision because it contains three components. One, by way of deposit. Component number two, by way of loan. Or three, is a wider jargon used, friends. Any other form, if you read any other form, you have to apply the legal maxim, ejusdem generis, which means if there is a general word, then you have to read it in conjunction with a special word, which means here, any other form, you have to apply it with the specific words, deposit or loan, as rightly mentioned by the Supreme Court in its judgment in State of Madras. This, however, does not include such categories of amounts as prescribed in consultation with RBI. Friends, this is not a meaning, this is a definition. Hence, it is important for us to comply with it in true law and spirit. Section 2, subsection 31 of Companies Act draws reference to deposits under Companies Act 2013. When you appreciate the difference with Companies Act 1956, you will know that here the provision assumes a wider connotation, because there it was only deposit which includes amount borrowed by the company. The exception is retained in 2013, where it says it shall not include such categories of amounts as prescribed in consultation with RBI. We all are aware that 2(1)(c) rule clearly gives the blessed provision of various exemptions which are available. Amount of loan or deposit which will not be construed as deposit. It's a big list, friends. Today we are going to not reproduce the entire 2(1)(c), but we are going to see it more in the light of an illustration for us to understand the reason behind this 2(1)(c) and this particular 2(1)(c) is very important because many of the companies, they draw shelter under 2(1)(c), but when they file this DPT-3, then they realize that these are no longer exemptions and they fall squarely under the ambit of deposits, which means they have to comply with the provisions of Chapter 5, which means if they have not complied with, there is a serious penalty attached to it. And hence, understanding this exemption list is very important for all the professionals and students. Depositor definition under 2(1)(d) is any person who has made a deposit with a public company in accordance with the provisions of Section 76 of the Act. If it is under Section 73, it will be a deposit made by any member. If it is public, it is as per the provisions of Section 76. Friends, the background of this Chapter 5 is Companies Act 2013 made higher accountability on all the companies because, one, to prevent malpractices, two, thanks to Sahara and various other episodes which made this provision harsh and punitive. Punitive because when we read the provisions of Section 74, where the contravention of the provisions of the previous Companies Act 1956 is also there, you cannot take shelter by saying that you had accepted deposits prior to this notification. No. Similarly, 76A section imposes severe penalty. So all these episodes have led to this stringent provision being imposed under Companies Act, friends. Not to threaten, but if we are going to fall within the provision, then it is fairly simple and easy to comply with. Deposit and loan, these are not synonymous, neither mutually exclusive. Various considerations that you will take note of in the nature of loan or deposit will certainly be dependent upon the facts, circumstances, and the intention of the parties. This is a well-established rule by Supreme Court, friends. in Veerappa Chettiar versus Annamalai Chettiar case. Eligible companies can accept deposit. This is the blessing available to eligible companies. Hence, it is important for us to understand which are those eligible companies where they can accept deposits. A public company, which means a private company, cannot accept deposits from public. Public company referred to in section 76(2), and the threshold is net worth of not less than 100 crores or turnover of not less than 500 crores. If you read net worth definition, you have to again go to section 2, subsection 57 of Companies Act. As auditors, we all are well aware of the net worth computation, where we take addition of paid up capital, all your free reserves, securities premium account, and you exclude your, of course, you will add your debit and credit balance in P&L account. Yes, Mr. Vamsi, you wanted to say something. Let's make it participative. Yeah. You'd like to say? Yeah. So excluding all your DRE, deferred revenue expenditure, miscellaneous expenditure, accumulated balances, and it will not, of course, include your revaluation reserve or any asset that is created by way of revaluation of the particular asset. So considering this net worth definition and turnover, turnover again draws reference to the definition as per the provisions of Companies Act 2, subsection 91, where it clearly says that the gross revenue that you will take for the purpose of your P&L account, which is your supply, distribution or provision of services or goods or both. So it could be a combination of goods and services, or if you're doing only goods, it will be your goods, supply, distribution, all aggregated to, and that turnover, if your amount is not less than 500 crores, then you are considered as an eligible company on obtaining prior approval in general meeting by passing a special resolution. So this is only a procedural norm which you can easily comply with. This explanation to this particular section 21E CAD rule clearly says that ordinary resolution will suffice if you are well within the limits of your 181C. What is 181C, friends? Your borrowing limit. So if your borrowing limit is well within the paid-up capital and free reserves considered, then a special resolution is not required. Mere ordinary resolution will be sufficient. Of course, you have to file the resolution with ROC, and we all are aware that form prescribed is MGT-40. Prohibition on accepting deposits. Deposit under Chapter 5 is classified into two categories. One, deposit from members. Two, deposits from public. No company other than eligible company shall accept or renew deposits from public, which means only eligible companies are entitled to. And since there is a reference drawn in all these provisions for eligible company, in the beginning itself we have seen what is an eligible company. Company shall, however, accept deposits from members, which means your private company, specified IFSC public company, all other companies other than eligible companies are given this particular privilege to accept from members, provided you comply with the CAD rules and the terms and conditions as provided under your section 73(2). There are certain exemptions from fulfilling these terms and conditions are also available to private company and specified IFSC public company. We will be seeing as to what are those specific conditions attached to these companies. What is a specified IFSC public company, friends? Specified IFSC public companies are those international financial service center companies which are set up and operated by Reserve Bank of India or SEBI or your IRDA, Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority, and which are operated from multi-services special economic zones, which are set up as per the provisions of your ACZ Act 2005, read with your ACZ rules 2006. We all are aware that like your private company notification, exemptions, privileges, wide MCA notification dated 5th June 2015, you had specified IFSC public companies, private companies notification wide 4th January 2017 notification, where several sections, exemption and privileges were granted to these companies. So this particular section is also a special privilege granted to these categories of companies. The provisions are of course not applicable to banking companies, non-banking financial companies as defined in RBI Act. Why, friends? Because you have a superior regulator there, specific regulator. You can't call RBI superior to MCA, but to avoid dual regulator purview, these companies which are already governed by RBI, they have the specific master directions on acceptance of deposits directions, which will certainly take precedence over these sections. And hence, a caveat is provided that for these companies which are regulated already by RBI under the specific act and the directions and regulations, this particular chapter is not applicable. So the reference is drawn not only in section 73. If you read rule 1 of CAD rules, it clearly starts with applicability. I always tell my students, for you to understand and appreciate a provision, first read the applicability and exemption. Half the problem will get solved, because you can knock out or weed out those sections which are not relevant to those categories of companies. So rule 1 is the important provision where you will clearly see that three classes of companies where this section is, chapter itself is not applicable. 1. NBFC. 2. Banking company. 3. NHBs, National Housing Bank, National HFCs, housing finance companies which are directed by NHBs. Now, of course, under RBI purview. And then those categories of companies as the central government may specify in consultation with RBI. This reference is again drawn in your rule 1. Of course, we have to wait and watch those companies which are specifically notified by central government. Specific conditions. Company accepting deposit shall satisfy the following conditions. You have to take approval from members by passing a resolution in general meeting. Rule 3, CAD rules shall be specifically complied with. This rule, it is imperative for us to note that it is applicable for both members and the public. And specific conditions in 73.2 shall be complied with. Friends, wherever there is a reference to acceptance, please note that renewal of deposits also, you have to comply with the same provisions. Terms and conditions under Rule 3. No deposit which is repayable on demand shall be accepted or renewed. And there is a tenor prescribed. You shall not accept deposit which is less than 6 months or beyond 3 years. And for less than 6 months, there is an exemption provided under this particular rule. What is that? Two conditions you have to satisfy. If it is only for the purpose of meeting short-term requirement and your deposit does not exceed 10% of your paid-up capital and free reserves, and it is a cumulative condition. If such deposits are repayable within 3 months from the date of such deposit, then you may take deposits lesser than 6 months also, provided you satisfy the twin conditions. Interest rate on deposits shall not exceed the maximum rate prescribed by RBI for deposits accepted by NBFC. If you read master directions on acceptance of deposit direction, the prescribed rate of interest is 12.5%, which means for deposits, you shall not exceed that particular ceiling as prescribed in your master directions. You can read regulation 9 of your master directions. Brokerage is as prescribed in your regulation 16, where it clearly says that your brokerage or commission or whatever you're going to pay for soliciting or for the purpose of accepting or inviting deposits shall not exceed 2%. And if there is going to be a reimbursement that you make for the brokerage, then it shall not exceed 0.5%, which means both put together, it is 2.5%. Company shall not alter the terms and conditions of deposits and related agreements after the circular is being issued and the deposits are accepted. Today, you are issuing the circular. Circular, we are going to see in Rule 4 in the subsequent slides, friends. So if you are going to make the terms and conditions prescribed, then after this particular issuance, before the deposits are accepted, you cannot constantly change the terms and conditions. This is more to protect the depositor's interest. Other conditions as provided in your 73.2, very important provision, issuance of circular with statement showing the financial position of the company to show that you have necessary credibility to make the payment of interest and repayment of your deposits, credit rating obtained. So you need to have the credit rating in place, because this section clearly says, subsection 8 clearly draws reference to credit rating, and every year you have to keep renewing the credit rating as well. Total number of depositors. So if you have already accepted a deposit and this is going to be either a renewal or second time deposit, you have to indicate the outstanding number of depositors and the previous deposit outstanding as well. This is clause A. B talks about the circular with statement being filed with ROC within 30 days before the date of issuance of this particular circular. We are going to see in the subsequent slide as to how the circular statement shall comprise the components as indicated in the respective rule of CAD rules. DRR account shall be maintained with a scheduled bank in which at least 20% of your deposit maturing during the following financial year shall be deposited on or before 30th April of each year. Due to the outbreak of COVID, we have seen that there were special measures given by MCA where this particular due date, they have extended the first circular up to 30th June, and now on 19th June, they have provided another circular wherein they have extended this date to September, which means for 30th April, for this financial year, you can do the deposit on or before 30th September. And statutory auditor of the company, here comes the auditor's role, where they have to clearly say that the company has not committed default in repayment of deposit, which means you have to see all these particular provisions and all the account statements to ensure that the company has complied with the making the payment of interest as well as making payment of deposits in the due date as specified. And if there has been any default, at least 5 years has elapsed from the date of making good the default. And providing security on deposits, including creation of charge. If the deposits are not secure, then every circular shall clearly indicate that these are unsecured deposits, which means the depositors will be alert while making this particular investment in your company. Rule 4 talks about your particulars in the circular or advertisement that you issue. For eligible company, it shall be advertised. For companies other than eligible company, it is sufficient if you circulate it to all their members. So that is the key difference between these two companies. So for eligible company, you shall issue the circular and this circular shall be advertised in form DPT-1. Friends, we all are aware that there are only 4 forms prescribed under Chapter 5. DPT-1 talks about your circular. DPT-2 talks about your trustee. DPT-3, which all of us are aware because enough deliberations have happened during the recent past, which is your one-time return of deposit from 1st April 2014 to 19, which is thanks to Rule 16A, or annual return on deposit, DPD-3, which is always there because it is a continuous obligation, which we will be seeing in the subsequent slide. But when we are talking about forms, I thought I will put all the 4 forms together. DPT-4 is for your transitional provision, which means if you had accepted deposits before this particular company's Act 2013, then you have to report in DPT-4. So only 4 forms for this chapter. This advertisement of the circular shall be in English and vernacular language, and you shall also place it on your website. And for companies other than eligible company, which means when you're going to accept deposit from your members, please issue the circular to all your members. And the mode is also prescribed. It clearly says you can do it through email also, or speed post or RPAD. And circular may be advertised in your English and vernacular newspaper. Maybe. That is the reason it is recommendatory in nature. Appointment of trustees. No company shall issue the circular unless the company has appointed debenture trustees. And Rule 7 of CAD rules clearly talks about the qualification of debenture trustee. Like your auditor's qualification. Like your director's qualification. Rule 7 clearly says that your debenture trustee should not have any pecuniary relationship with the company. What is pecuniary? The material relationship with the company should not be there. And he should, so that he can take care of the interest of the deposit holders. And he should not be a director of this company or holding subsidiary or associate company. Or he should not be a relative of all these companies, which means the company or its HSA, holding subsidiary associate company. Or he should not have given any guarantee to any of these arrangements, making him an obligatory person for reporting these transactions. So he should ideally be an independent person. And DTD shall be executed in form DPT-2 7 days before issuance of this particular circular. And trustees shall not be removed before the issuance of this circular and before the expiry of the term, except, so you can do so provided you obtain all the directors' approval, which also includes, there is a proviso attached to this rule which clearly says that if your company has an independent director, please ensure compliance to take consent from your ID as well. Another key notable feature is you have to take prior consent from the debenture trustee. In this particular form, DPT2, you have to attach his consent also, like how you file along with ADT1 the consent letter of the statutory auditor. Like that, you have to attach the consent letter of trustee. Other conditions attached to section 73 are deposits shall be repaid in accordance with the terms and conditions of the agreement, which means it shall be well in consonance with your DTD, deposit trustee. And in case of the default in repayments, the recourse available to your depositor is he can apply to tribunal. Tribunal is your NCLT, National Company Law Tribunal. You all are aware that prior to this particular notification, we had Company Law Board. Now it is NCLT for non-payment of the deposits. Friends, it could be even interest. So not necessary that you have to wait till the principal amount is repaid by the company. Even if it is an interest payment and you have incurred a loss or damage, you may certainly make a representation to the tribunal. And it could be an association of persons or a single person is as the act provides, which means you can have a cartel arrangement to form all the group of deposit holders to make this representation to the tribunal. And DRR account shall be used only for the purpose of repayment of deposit, like any other specific reserve, like your debenture redemption reserve, used only for the purpose of repayment of debentures. Similarly, your deposit repayment reserve account shall be used only for the purpose of repayment of deposit. And section 73 also provides the fact that you can have joint holders not exceeding three names. And it also provides a mode that it could be either or survivor or first named joint holder. So the terminology could be as the company wants. Credit rating 73.8 clearly mandates the company to obtain credit rating at least once in every year. You shall obtain this particular credit rating as accepted and renew this particular credit rating, and they are again drawing reference to the credit rating agencies as specified for NBFCs. If you read the Master Direction on Provision and Acceptance of Deposit, Regulation 14 clearly provides reference to 7 agencies, which are those CRAs from whom the credit rating shall be obtained by these companies accepting deposit. CARE, ICRA, CRISIL, Fitch, SME, Brickwork, and Informatics Valuation and Rating. These are the 7 agencies from where the credit rating shall be obtained from these companies accepting deposit. And it shall not be below the minimum investment credit rating or other specified rating. So if you read the direction, it clearly provides these agencies vis-a-vis the credit rating which you have to obtain from these agencies. AA-, MMA-, MA-. So all these ratings you have to comply with, and the rating shall also be an annexure to your form DPT3. This is a summation of all these limits which we have seen, just a snapshot. For members, private company up to 100% of paid up capital, free reserves and securities premium account. Can a private company accept deposit from public? No, it is strictly prohibited. Other than private company, it is up to 35% of your paid up capital. For eligible companies, they have clearly provided this bifurcation. 10% for members, for public it is 25%. For common company, it is 35% of paid up capital, free reserves, securities premium account. For specified IFSC public companies, it is up to 100% of paid up capital plus free reserves plus securities premium. So if you read column number 1 and 5, the limits are the same for private company and specified IFSC public company. And these companies, though the condition for 73.2 is exempted for these companies, the limit, the ceiling limit is not there for these companies. They have to report these particular amounts, whatever they have procured in DPT3, is the provision under CAD rules together with section 73. So the relaxation is for a startup private company for a period of 5 years from the date of incorporation. So which are those startup companies? Again, there is a reference drawn under Companies Act. So those private companies, so only a startup company which is a private company, you can claim exemption, friends. And those which are accredited by your DIPP, Department of Industry Policy, under Ministry of Commerce and Industry, where these companies are classified as startup companies, and a private company which fulfills all the conditions. Friends, underline the phrase, all the conditions. So it shall not be an associate or subsidiary of any other company. So it should be a simpliciter independent private company, not associated with any group company. And the borrowings from banks, financial institutions, or any body corporate is less than twice of its paid up capital, or 50 crores, whichever is lower. And very important, they should not have any subsisting default in repayment of borrowings. So the maximum limit for deposit from the members are not applicable to these companies. And as mentioned just now, they have to file this particular detail in form DPT3 with the details of money accepted. Section 74 is your transitional provision providing accommodation to all the deposits which you had accepted before the Companies Act 2013. 73, 74, friends, notified effective 1st April 2014 itself. So where amount of deposits or part thereof or interest due remains unpaid on the date of the commencement of the Act, the company shall file DPT4 within 3 months from the date of commencement of Act, which means on or before 30th June, you shall complete this filing of DPT4. And again, it is a cumulative condition. You shall repay within 3 years. So they've given this leeway of 3 years for repaying this particular deposit or when it comes for expiry, which means 1st April 2014 and then 16. If your deposit is becoming due, then you should have repaid and you can't wait till your 3 year period. And renewal shall be done only in accordance with Chapter 5. After this 15, once you make the repayment, then you cannot take shelter in the Section 58A of Companies Act. You have to come under Chapter 5 of Companies Act 2013, a logical conclusion. A tribunal can also allow extension. Suppose I have a financial crunch and I have made a representation to tribunal, then you are allowed to take shelter under the old provisions, considering the fact that the new provisions are quite stringent, provided the tribunal grants approval for the same. Contravention of this provision will be a company liability from 1 crore up to 10 crores. For officer in default, it is 25 lakhs to 2 crores or imprisonment up to 7 years or both, as rightly mentioned by our chief guest today. Damages for fraud, Section 75. Without prejudice to 74 and 447. Friends, what is 447? Punishment for fraud. Knowingly or willfully, if you are going to commit these provisions with an intention to defraud. So intention to defraud is very important there. It is proved that the deposits are accepted with an intention to deceive the depositors, then every officer responsible for acceptance of deposit is personally liable. Not only the fine, friends, personal liability. So this has a serious repercussion. And any suit, not only that, any legal proceeding can be taken by the depositor affected on the company. Deposits from public, Section 76. 76, important provision, but all the regulations and the stringent norms which we saw for Rule 73, that is Rule 3, from Rule 3 to Rule 21 will squarely apply for your 76 deposits from public. So eligible companies shall accept deposit from public subject to compliance with Section 73(2) and rules as central government may prescribe, which is your CAD rules. Such companies shall obtain credit rating. So credit rating we have discussed in length as to those agencies and the minimum investment grading that should be obtained, and they shall create a charge on the assets of the amount. And this particular charge creation, you shall file within 30 days from the date of acceptance of deposits. Your CHG1 is a form prescribed for this particular security which you create. Security for deposits. This section clearly says that those assets which you shall take for creating security for deposit. Not only that, it clearly says that if you are going to value the security, say for example, the valuation of assets comes to 50 crores. But my deposit is 60 crores. Can I accept deposit up to 60? No. It shall be restricted up to the market value as assessed by virtue of your valuation. So all companies shall provide security by way of charge on the assets as referred in your Schedule 3. and the security for this particular asset includes both mobile and immobile. However, intangible assets will not be considered for this purpose, and the value reckoned will be your amount of deposit, principal plus interest, shall not exceed the market value of the assets assessed by a registered valuer again. So the important provision, penalty. So only when we know the penalty, we will know the importance of complying with this particular section. Company, amount of deposit or part thereof, together with the interest which is due, along with fine of 1 crore or twice the amount of deposit, whichever is lower, which may extend up to 10 crores. For officer in default, there is imprisonment for a term not exceeding 7 years and fine of 25 lakhs, which may extend to 2 crores. And if it is proved that he has contravened willfully or with an intention to defraud the, deceive the company or shareholders or deposit holders or the creditors, he shall be liable for action under 447. 447 again draws reference to your punishment for fraud, and where it clearly says that the amount shall be not less than the amount that you defraud, and it's the maximum ceiling is thrice the amount of the defraud, and it also clearly says that the imprisonment shall be at least for a period of 6 months and it shall go up to 10 years. And contravention of CAD rules, rule 21 says that fine shall be up to 5,000, and for continuous default it is 500 for every day during which the default continues. Some of the other provisions, we will just take a quick glance so that we don't leave any of the important provisions in CAD rules, friends. Register shall be maintained at the registered office, and this particular rule clearly says the aspects which you have to cover in the register of deposits, just like a fixed asset register. And entry shall be recorded within 7 days from the date of issue of your deposit receipt. Deposit receipt also, the rule clearly says what are the minute details you have to give to your deposit holder in the deposit receipt. The amount that you received, the serial number, deposit receipt number. So everything should be captured there. And this particular record shall be maintained for a period of not less than 8 years. And for penal interest, there is a specific rule which says that every company shall pay penal rate of interest at 18% per annum for overdue period. So from the day due date till the day actual date of payment, you have to compute for 18% matured and claimed but remaining unpaid. And every private company shall disclose in its notes about the money received from directors or relatives of directors. Thanks to the amendment, previously you had only directors, and then they brought in relatives of directors also. And every other company shall disclose the details of money received from directors. For other companies, they have to provide the details of the money received from directors. So we all are aware that here there should be a declaration that we have to obtain, that the money is obtained only from the own funds and not from borrowed funds. Why? Because otherwise it will be like a circumventing route to again lead to deposit. To prevent that, they say that it shall be out of own funds and backed by a declaration and disclosure in your financial statements. Return of deposits. All of us are aware, so I'll just take a second to explain about this particular slide. DPD3, on or before 30th June of every year, you have to file the annual return with the particulars of deposits as on 31st March, duly audited by your auditor. So the auditor's acknowledgement and certificate of the numbers is very important. And one-time return is your DPT3 under Rule 16A, which shall be filed by all the companies except common company. Of course, all the exempted category of companies will not come here because Rule 1 clearly carves out those companies having outstanding borrowing from the period is 1st April 14 till 31st March 2019. This, which is not considered as deposit, which means all the list of deposits as provided in your 21C, the big list, which we will also see in the illustration now, that particular amount which you have received, even if it is not a deposit, you have to report it under Form DPT3. Friends, there is a clarification where it clearly says that if there is no outstanding borrowing as on 31st March, then DPT3 for one-time return is not required to be filed. We discussed already, due to the outbreak of COVID, for DRR account, there is an extension. First special measure circular granted extension till 30th June, and void MCA circular 19 June, further extension up to 30th September is provided. We are going to see two case laws before we conclude this segment, acceptance of deposit. Meena Subhash Kulkarni and others, versus Nisa Agritech and Foods Limited and others. So the petitioner company here, the Meena Subhash Kulkarni and others, the petitioners are the joint applicants who have given the deposit to this particular company. So the company which has accepted deposit is Nisa Agritech. This company had accepted deposit before this particular commencement of the Act, Chapter 5. However, they failed to repay the deposit even after the maturity date. There comes the issue. So the deposit holders approached CLB because CLB was the then authority to resolve this particular matter for deposit holders. They passed an order sanctioning this particular payment to be made to the deposit holders on 13th October 2014. In spite of this, the company did not repay the deposit. Therefore, the deposit holders again sought this particular remedy through NCLT, being the current tribunal which can sanction this particular remedy, seeking direction to repay the deposit amount. And the petitioner stated that they gave representation to regional director and other corporate officials as well about the non-receipt of this particular money. Learned counsel appearing on behalf of the company claimed that the deposits were made prior to 1st April and the relief under 73(4) can be granted for deposits accepted under 73(2). But the learned counsel appearing on behalf of deposit holders claimed that 73(4) is also applicable for deposits which were accepted prior to 1st April. They relied upon this judgment of NCLT Delhi in the matter of Bimala Kothari versus Unitech Limited, where it was clearly held that even if the deposits were accepted before 1st April, due remedy shall be granted under Companies Act 2013. So NCLT Delhi bench decision was taken as reference by Ahmedabad bench in this case. And they considered the same view and held that direction can be given to repay the deposit accepted prior to 1st April also. And the order was sanctioned under 73(1). It prohibits acceptance or renewal of deposit. 73(2) enables the company to accept deposit provided they follow the procedures as enshrined in 73(2), read with all the CAD rules. 73(4) grants remedy to all these deposit holders in the event of non-payment of interest or the principal component to them, and hence this particular shelter can certainly be taken by this particular deposit holders. And the final order was sanctioned on 17 Jan 2018 directing the company and directors to repay the deposit within 30 days from the date of this order. Another case, Sumati Sharma versus Unitech Limited. Here the principal amount of 2 lakhs was offered by the decree holder as a fixed deposit carrying rate of interest at 12.5% being the maximum rate as prescribed by RBI. Deposit matured on 9th Feb 2016. However, the company failed to pay both the principal amount and interest accrued. The decree holder sought execution of this particular order backed by an affidavit, and they sought satisfaction of the deposit amount together with interest through attachment from judgment debtor's bank account maintained with ICICI. And tribunal granted direction for freezing this particular debit in the ICICI bank account. And since they had sufficient balance, NCLT gave its final order on 12th July 2018 to release a demand draft for 2,50,000 being the principal component together with the interest which they had arrived at in the name of the decree holder in full and final settlement as a discharge of the fixed deposit holder. We'll see 3 illustrations in the light of this particular subject to understand it better. This private company had a paid up capital of 10 crores and they had a borrowing from HDFC of 12 crores, which means twice the paid up capital is 20 crores. This particular borrowing is less than the twice the paid up capital. There was no subsisting default in borrowing. And another condition for private company, which is not related to any other subsidiary or associate company or any other company, was also fulfilled by this company. What if the company had accepted deposits before? Deposits from members before 1st April. Is it a deposit? No. But will the situation be different if it is accepted after 1st April? Yes. For before 1st April, you have to disclose these in the notes to financial statements with such amount and accounting head in the financial statement, because there was ambiguity as to what will happen to these acceptance of deposits from members prior to 1st April. So there was a clarification issued by MCA. Why did circular dated 30th March 2015? And hence, if you make the reporting of these particular deposits in your notes and the accounting head where these are classified in your financial statements, that will suffice the requirement. But after the position after 1st April is completely different because it is a deposit and without limits, without complying with section 73(2)(a) to (e), you can certainly take this deposit because it is well within those three conditions which we discussed. Next illustration. Here, Anand, the director of Shree Private Limited, provided loan of 2 crores to a company. Will it be a deposit? No. Why? Because it will not be a deposit because it is accepted from the director of a company. So the director means you have to comply with only the requirement because rule 2(1)(c) clearly exempts the private company if they are accepting deposit from director, provided they get a declaration from the director that it was out of his own funds. And such disclosure is made in the both report. Most of the companies, what they do is they get this declaration, but they miss out this reporting in both report, which will be a violation of your section 134 read with this relevant rule. So please ensure compliance to reporting in your both report as well. So here comes third list illustration, more to draw reference to your 2(1)(c) exemption list, friends. I did not want to reproduce the entire 2(1)(c), so I thought to make it more live, I'll bring it as an illustration for us to, one, understand the provision and for us to know the intricacies involved in 2(1)(c). Niyati Private Limited wanted to accept deposit from public. Can they do? No, strictly prohibited. Sakshi Private Limited wanted to accept deposit from members, but they had default in filing financial statements. Friends, there is a clear provision. After 19 September 2015, the provision clearly says that if there is a default in filing AOC 4 or your MGT 7, then the benefit of the exemption notification granted to private companies is not available and enhanced limits are also not allowed. The enhanced limit being your 100% of paid-up capital, which we discussed already, which means it is important for all these companies to file the annual financial statements to get the benefit under deposit rules. An unsecured subordinated debt issued to a resident individual by Anand Limited. It is not listed. Is it a deposit? Yes. Why? Because effective June, you had this particular amendment only for listed unsecured debentures, which means if it is unlisted, then it will squarely fall within the purview of deposits. Unsecured PDI instruments issued to Pragati Limited. Is it a deposit? Not a deposit. Because the PDI again issued to another company where your ICDs come, intercorporate deposit. Unsecured compulsorily convertible debentures issued to resident individual by Anand Limited, not listed but convertible after a term of 5 years. It is not a deposit. Why? Because again, the company's acceptance of deposit amendment rules clearly provided additional benefit to those convertible debentures provided the term is up to a maximum of 10 years. Here it is only 5 years and hence it is not a deposit. Promoters of Shree provided finance in pursuance of stipulation imposed by HDFC. This is not a deposit. Friends, Rule 2(1)(c) clearly provides three conditions for a promoter if he is going to give a loan to the company in order to claim it as an exempted deposit. What are they? One, the promoter should have given it only in pursuance of the stipulation of this particular financial institution. Here it is. And a stipulation imposed by HDFC Bank. Point number two, it should be out of his own funds, which means again, like a director, he should not have borrowed funds and given it to the company. It should be out of his own funds, the promoter should have given. Point number three, the promoter or relatives, when they have given this out of their own funds, pursuant to this stipulation by the financial institution, the term of this particular loan should be subsisting. So if it is like the term is 3 years and the promoter's loan is continuing, you cannot take shelter under this particular provision. Krishna Private Limited availed intercorporate deposit. So this is one of the important provision which most of us have a doubt whether ICDs are within the exempted purview or not. Yes, ICDs are well within the exempted deposit. No worries. Swaroop Limited received 100 crore from IFC, International Finance Corporation. Friends, 2(1)(c). Point number two clearly draws reference to amount received from multilateral financial institutions. We all are aware that IFC is a multilateral MFI category, and hence this particular amount is not a deposit. Likewise, if you are going to receive money from central government, state government, or any subsidies that you receive, or any amount that is guaranteed by CG or SG, then it is not a deposit. 2(1)(c)(1) clearly draws reference. Pranav Private Limited received loan from bank. Again, 2(1)(c)(3) clearly says that if you are going to receive any amount from public financial institutions or any banking company as defined in the Banking Regulation Act or a corresponding new bank as defined in the Act, then they are exempted deposits. Shakshi Limited received money against issuance of commercial papers, CPs, but they are not in accordance with RBI guidelines. Friends, 2(1)(c) clearly says that only if CPs are issued in accordance with the RBI guidelines, it is an exempted deposit. Otherwise, they are deposits. Prakriti Private Limited received 10 lakhs from Deva, an employee, as non-interest bearing security deposit. Still, it is a deposit because there is a condition attached under that provision that it should not exceed his annual salary. Here in this case, assuming that Deva was receiving 8 lakhs as annual salary, but this particular amount received by the company is over and above his annual salary, and hence it is a deposit. Swagat Limited received share application money during 2019, but shares were not allotted till March 2020 and money was not refunded. Friends, please remember, any share application money that you receive should be allotted within 60 days as per your provisions under 3942 of the Act, which are the charging provisions. But either you allot or refund the money, and the refund shall happen within 15 days from the expiry of 60 days. But if you're not going to either allot or refund, then you will fall within the ambit of deposit. Serious repercussion. Please ensure that the share application money, as and when you report in your share capital statement, ensure that it is well within the timeline as prescribed in the deposit rules. Here, there is also, you have a doubt, Vamsi?
No, you can carry.
Yeah, shall we proceed? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so there is a transitional provision also for your old Companies Act, where you never had the 60-day timeline, if you recollect. There again, this proviso to 2(1)(c) clearly says that if you had received money under the previous Companies Act, which is due till 31st March 15. Why 31st March they have mentioned? Because annual financial statements, when you are reporting, you will get to know that the share application money is pending. There again, the timeline is provided under CAD rules, which says on or before 1st June 2015, please make refund of this particular money. Otherwise, it will fall within the deposit ambit. Segment 1, hope we all are clear, friends. Shall we move on to 185? If you have any questions, I shall be glad to take. Otherwise, we can move on to 185. Another interesting provision. Okay, friends, let's move on to 185. Thankfully, we have the liberalized provision 185. Previous 185, after this particular provision was notified, effective 12 September 2013, because in the first phase itself, this particular 185 was notified. There was a big hue and cry because it was made common to all the companies, private company, public companies. So private company, why should it be considered on par with public companies? So having received several representations from various professional bodies, industry members and associations, thankfully, this particular prohibitive section is made prohibitive come restrictive, which means private companies, if they are under the conditions which are provided under 185, for these companies, the exemption was granted by 5th June 2015 under 185, provided three conditions are satisfied. We will be seeing those provisions. Though the liberalized regime is provided, friends, under 185, in order to balance this with the corporate governance norm, stringent penalties are also provided under 185(4) because directors assume fiduciary obligation and they are acting in the interest of the company and they are in an elevated position, assuming the role as trustees of the company, and hence they have the duty to disclose their interest in the company. With this important background, and for the directors to assume this important role in the company, and when they have to certainly exercise due diligence and care, 185 clearly draws reference to prohibition from providing loans to directors and restriction in advancing loans to directors. So we will see the distinction between the prohibition and restriction. Prohibition is 185(1), restriction is 185(2). Prohibition only for few matters where it is directly involving the director. Restriction is with regard to those companies where the person connected is involved as a director, which means if he is connected with a private company or body corporate with a specified threshold as prescribed in 185(2), the company may advance loan provided they comply with minimal conditions as provided, which are doable norms only. 185(3) provides various exemptions for those loans or guarantees given or securities provided. 185(4) deals with the contravening provisions more to make this an onerous responsibility on the company and the officers in default and the person who avails loan from the company. With this brief background, let's get into the provision. Loan. Loan is not defined in the Act. In general parlance, it is a transaction in which money is given with an intention to return the money either with interest or without interest. What is guarantee? Guarantee is to perform the promise or discharge the liability. So, I am acting as a guarantor when there is a borrower, and when I am going to sign the loan agreement, in the event of this default only, I will step into the shoes, acting as a guarantor. Security. Security, the reference is drawn again to your 281 of Companies Act, where 281 safely draws reference to your specific section, section 2H of your Securities Contract Regulation Act, where Securities Contract Regulation Act gives these list of instruments: shares, scrip, bonds, debentures, debenture stock in or of any incorporated company or body corporate. Loans to directors, 185. The bar created by law to grant loans were lifted, and the power to decide the same has been transferred to shareholders. Why the power is given to shareholders? Shareholders are the owners of the company. Let them take the benefit of doubt of whether to grant the loan or not. Friends, if you recollect the previous provision under 295, we had to take approval from central government. So now, from a governing body, this provision is moved to a self-governing body, which means from central government to shareholders. So the power is narrowed down, which means the company shall take necessary responsibility to ensure that it is well in compliance with the provisions of 185. And the rules relating to group companies were relaxed to a larger extent, with the condition stating that the amount shall be used only for principal business. Why, friends? Because you shall certainly focus on giving the loan only for your activities and not for investing in some other company and making profit out of it, because it is your hard-earned money of the shareholders. You should not be divesting the fund for your own jolly well investing or providing loan and making benefit out of it, because your principal business could be tea manufacturing, and you should not be engaging in financing activity of investing in some other financial institution or lending, granting loan to some other institution and making money out of it, because that is not the intent with which your shareholders have approved the objects of the company. Restriction on loans. So 185(1) clearly restricts these loans. There is no second thought. Any director of the lending company, strict no if he is going to ask for loan from the lending company. Directly or indirectly, you shall not give loan, which is very important. What is indirectly granting loan, friends? Indirectly means you should not be approaching through an agent or one or more intermediaries. Even then, it is prohibited. Director of holding company or any partner or relative of such director or any firm in which the directors or partners or relatives. So all these four categories of people you shall not be advancing loan or giving guarantee or providing security. Fairly simple to understand without any complication. Who are relatives? 277, subsection 77, read with your rule 4 of company specification of definition rules, clearly provides the exhaustive list of people who are your relatives. Hindu undivided family members, related persons under your rule 4, spouse, father, mother, son, daughter, spouse of your son and daughter, of course, brother, sister. So for your father, mother, son, brother, sister, step, son, mother, brothers, father, all are considered. First is your 185(1) restriction. Relaxation, the blessing provided in 185(2). What are they? Company may advance loan to any person in whom the director is interested. Who are those persons who are in whom the director is interested? Again, an exhaustive list is thankfully provided without leading to ambiguity. Who are they? Any private company in which such director is a director or member, any body corporate at a general meeting of which more than 25% of the voting power, which means your equity share capital is considered, not your pref capital, is exercised or controlled by any such director or two or more directors. Any body corporate, the board is accustomed to act in accordance with the directions of this director or the directors of this lending company. So these exhaustive list of members are those persons in whom the director is considered to be interested as per the explanation given in 185(2). Relaxation is also provided under 185(3) for loans granted to your MD whole-time director. Of course, with a condition. What is that? If you are extending such loan to all the employees, so all is very important because it should not be a specific benefit that you grant to your MD or whole-time director. If you are giving it to Tom, Dick and Harry, being employees of the company, you are giving the same benefit to your MD and whole-time director, then you are not within the purview of 185. Or pursuant to a scheme approved by the members, you may do so provided your members, the shareholders who are the investors, they approve this by a special resolution. Why special resolution? To bring in more number of members to approve the transaction. In the ordinary course of business, you provide loan or give guarantee or provide security. So this is a favorite question from all the NBFC. I am NBFC company. Am I coming within the ordinary course of business? This is the question which they generally ask us. Yes, if it is in the ordinary course, means you are lending money, which is your principal business. Hence, you are out of the purview of 185 by virtue of 185(3). Providing interest at a rate. So there is a caveat here, which is very important for us to note. Not less than the prevailing yield of governing government security closest to the tenor of the loan. So if it is a 1 year loan, it shall be, the rate of interest shall certainly be in consonance with the government security rate of interest, the prevailing yield. Likewise, for 3 years, 10 years also, the same rate of interest should be charged. Why? To make it arm's length transaction and not otherwise. Holding and wholly owned subsidiary. This was one of the great lacuna in the previous provision because restriction was imposed on holding WOS also. Then how will wholly owned subsidiary, when the holding company itself is not granting loan, how will a bank or financial institution provide loan? So this is a serious issue and this was well addressed. Why? This Companies Amendment Act 2017, effective 7th May 2018, clearly says that if it is for the principal business activity of your wholly owned subsidiary, and if you are going to grant loan or provide security or give guarantee, then it is squarely outside the ambit of 185. And holding subsidiary, which means there is a difference drawn under 185(3), friends, which is important for us to appreciate and understand. For wholly owned subsidiary, it is loan guarantee security. When it comes to subsidiary, which is even if it is 99.99, you can only provide guarantee or security, not a loan. So if you are going to give loan, then it is contravening the provision of 185. Mark the difference. This we have seen. Specified IFSC and IFSC private company. By virtue of your notification dated 4 January 2017, these specified class of companies were granted relaxation, like your private company notification, June 2015. Any private company of which such director is a director, in which the director of the lending company is not having any direct or indirect shareholding through himself or through the relatives and a special resolution is passed, then this particular relaxation is available for those IFSC companies. Not only that, central government has exempted these specific class of companies by their official gazette notification on 5th June. Private company, three principal conditions have to be satisfied. Friends, please note that lot of professionals ask us this doubt. This particular section was amended on 7th May. Private company notification came on 5th June. Whether this particular notification benefit is still available is the question asked very much. Why? The intent of the notification is to grant benefit to the private companies, and hence this 5th June 2015 is a specific notification to private companies which will prevail, but they have to comply with the conditions as clearly imposed in that notification. Those three conditions are: no other body corporate should have invested any money in this particular private company in its share capital, which means you have a private company ABC, you have two subscribers, Meenakshi and Vamsi. So if they are two individuals, then you are certainly reaping the benefit under exemption notification. You have three members, Meenakshi, Vamsi and XYZ Private Limited, then you cannot take benefit under this exemption notification. Please appreciate the difference. And if the borrowing is less than twice the paid up capital or 50 crores, whichever is lower. So this is again a threshold. We already read this particular threshold in our CAD rules also. Please try to recollect. And there is no subsisting default, which was also prevailing there, which means you should not have any default in your borrowing repayments. For Nidhi company, if the loan is given to a director or relative in his capacity as member, and you make this disclosure in your notes to financial statement. And for government company, the exemption is if it obtains approval from the ministry or department of central government or state government concerned with regard to this particular transaction, then the exemption is very much available. Not only that, the body corporate is the language which we saw in the previous slide. If you recollect, the person in whom the director is interested clearly talks about body corporate, which means trust or your other companies, which is your societies, are not body corporate, and hence this particular provision is not applicable. So loan given to a trust registered under the Indian Trust Act, even when the director acts as a trustee, is not a body corporate, and loan to a society registered under Society Registration Act is only body of individuals and not a body corporate, and hence the following transactions are not covered. We will conclude this segment 2 with a case law, an interesting case law, very recent one, and illustration on this transaction to appreciate it better, friends. This case law in 2020 is between Eastern Condiments Private Limited vis-a-vis ROC Kerala. These two are group companies, Eastern Condiments and Istia Chai Private Limited. The board of Eastern Condiments at its meeting held on 24th May had approved for advancing loan up to 40 crores. Interest was 9%. And of course, for working capital requirement to meet its suppliers. As the name goes, it was for spice, condiments, and various other tea and other manufacturing only. So for working capital, in line with their business only, they had availed loan, no doubt. But friends, highlighting factors, they had obtained approval only from the board. But the section clearly says that they should have obtained approval from shareholders. That is where the missing point. So case in 2020, where board of Eastern Condiments passed only board resolution. Petitioner company claimed that inadvertently they failed to obtain the shareholders' approval. Of course, after providing this particular loan to this Eastia Chai, they did ratify this particular transaction by taking shareholders' approval, which happened on 19 September 2019. Legislator has taken a lenient view, no doubt about it, but to grant loan only after passing a special resolution. So the fact remains that loan shall be granted after passing a special resolution. But general provisions of 185 exempts private companies, which we saw just now. But 185 applies to this company. Why? Because they had a body corporate as a shareholder, which means in our example, we saw that XYZ Private Limited was also a shareholder in ABC, which means ABC cannot lend by taking shelter under the exemption notification. Istia Chai is one of the group companies in which two directors are common, which means they are fairly under the person in whom the company is connected and interested. The company could have granted loan because there is no restriction by way of relaxation, provided they had satisfied two conditions. What are they? Special resolution in a general meeting and with explanatory statement containing three facts, which are very important because the section clearly mandates and you cannot have a compromise on the subject. One, you have to give full particulars of the loan. Two, the purpose for which the loan is being utilized, which means for Istia Chai, if they're going to use it for working capital, they should have clearly obtained shareholders' approval by making this material fact disclosed in their statement. Point number three, if there are any other relevant facts which you want to disclose to shareholders, please do so. These are the three points as provided in the section. But this company failed to do so, which we have noticed. The loans should be utilized for principal business activity. Of course, they have utilized it for their working capital requirement to meet their suppliers' demand. The petitioner company inadvertently contravened the provision. The penalty under 184 are as follows. For lending company, it is 5 lakhs to 25 lakhs. For officer in default, friends, previous section 185, as notified on 12 September, never had officer in default. But now, the provision for imposing corporate governance made mandatory for directors, officers, key managerial personnel, which includes your company secretary, CFO of the company, or any other person who is empowered by the board as officer in default, these officers are also included, prior to which you had only directors or the borrowing party, which means any other person who is connected with this particular director. So fine is the same for these two segments, which is fine of 5 lakhs up to 25 lakhs or imprisonment for a period of 6 months or both. Thankfully, it is a compound double offense because you have fine or imprisonment or both. Final order was imposed since they had clearly claimed that it was inadvertent omission. 5 lakhs was imposed, provided they wanted it to be a deterrent for not repeating the default in future. Here, A Limited is the holding company. X is the wholly owned subsidiary. Y is subsidiary. Friends, we already noted the significant fact that for wholly owned, you can provide loan guarantee security and hence there is a tick mark for all the three segments. Whereas for subsidiary, you can only give guarantee or provide security. Loan is not permitted transaction provided. Section 185.3 clearly says that it shall be for your principal business activity. So with this illustration, we have understood 185.3. 185.1 and 2, let's understand by this illustration 2. Element Limited, lending company, directors Element. HIG Limited, where directors of the holding company are HIJ. So 185.1 clearly prohibits you from providing loan to the directors of Element Limited and HIG, which means LMN, HIJ, all the directors strict no if they are going to ask loan from you. Partners of these directors strict no. Relatives, again no. Firm in which one or three, which means for all LMN, HIJ, if they are partners in any firm, you cannot grant loan. But for any private company in which LMN, HIJ or directors or members, you can grant loan by virtue of 185.2. And any body corporate in which at a general meeting, 25% or more of the voting power is exercised by LMN, HIJ, you can provide loan. And for any body corporate where the board is, for example, there is a body corporate XYZ where LMN, HIJ only have the superior role, only based on their direction or instruction, they have significant operating influence on the policy decisions, then they will certainly be considered as accustomed to act. Again, accustomed to act is not defined in the act, friends, but for the benefit of understanding, I am referring this illustration. You can provide loan, but pass a special resolution and the borrower shall be only for the principal business activity of this company. Final illustration to conclude this provision, RP, a director of Om Private Limited, avail loan of 2 crores from the company. Paid up capital is 10 crores, borrowing is 12 crores. Friends, we read under 5th June 2015 notification that you have to comply with three conditions for a private company to grant exemption. What are they? One, the borrowing is twice, not exceeding twice the paid up capital. Here, twice the paid up capital is your 20 crores, whereas your borrowing is less than 20 crores, which is 12 crores. Hence, they are fulfilling one condition. Point number two is what? None of the body corporate should be a member of this private company. Assuming that in this private company, only two individuals are members. Third condition, assuming that this company, there is no repayment borrowing which is subsisting, which means if there is a default in any of the borrowings which they have availed from SBI or any other financial institution, then they cannot claim benefit under exemption notification. So assuming that all these three conditions are satisfied, this particular loan is exempt from the purview of 185. Last segment for the day session, 192. Simple provision as compared to our chapter 5 or 185. You can relax and listen to 192. I think I have bothered you all enough with chapter 5 and 185 for the day. So 192, you can relax and listen to me. Very simple provision to understand and very easy to comply with. But why do we have this provision? Friends, directors have fiduciary obligation and they are acting in the interest of the company and they assume the role as trustees of the company. And one of the important duties for them is to report their interest as directors, which is why we have MBP 1, where they have to disclose their interest pursuant to 184 of the Companies Act. 192 is a new concept under Companies Act, where non-cash transactions, if there are any transaction where there is particular interest to the director, be it acquisition, that is buying or selling, though this particular new concept is broad, the scope is limited to only two transactions. What are they? One is company acquiring from director, two is director acquiring from company, so which could be you are purchasing or selling. Other transactions are not covered. This is a welcome change, no doubt, but the legislation would also require further tightening up to provide other transactions also, so that it is well protecting the interest of the stakeholders who are investing in the company or your creditors or the shareholders. A welcome change, simple provision. Only for this transaction, you have to comply with 2 points. Approval from your shareholders and valuation, which we are going to see. Some of the relevant terms for this particular section are to acquire. What is acquire? Take possession of something which necessarily involves two parties, buyer and seller. Transfer between a company and a director or a person connected with director. Friends, person connected with director is again an addition here. But if you ask me whether there is a definition or explanation given in the Act, no. It failed to draw reference to a person connected to a director by giving a definition. However, reference can be drawn to explanation in 185.2, which we saw just now, which means a private company, body corporate, where more than 25% voting power is held by this director, or a body corporate which is accustomed to act in accordance with the directions of the director. So those three provisions you can consider for person connected with the director. Non-cash transaction, is it defined? It is not defined, but you can draw reference to AS 3, Accounting Standards 3, which refers to non-cash transaction. Transactions that do not require use of cash or cash equivalent. Let's understand this provision with a fairly simple illustration. Here, company A is the party involved. Director or person connected with this particular company A, or one, company A, two, the holding company, three, subsidiary company, four, associate company. So it could be, the transaction could revolve around these four parties. And what is the transaction which we are discussing? Either buying or selling, which means company acquiring from director or director acquiring from company, which is the Act Section 192.1 clearly says, company acquiring or to acquire. So proposed to acquire could also be a part of this transaction. When this particular 192.1 gets attracted, you have to comply with simple provision of getting prior approval from your members. Friends, if it is prior approval, please don't ask this question whether post facto approval is allowed. No. So ratification is not permitted. Before you enter into the transaction, get the approval from the members in a general meeting. again, special resolution is not specified here, which means you can jolly well do so by passing an ordinary resolution, where the director or connected person is a director of the holding company. Prior approval in general meeting of the company involved in the transaction and the holding company shall be obtained. Let's try to understand this particular provision with this illustration only. For example, company A is planning to sell an asset to the director of the holding company, which is company B. For this particular transaction, the company A shall also take prior approval from shareholders, and company B shall also take approval from its, that is the holding company and the company which is involved in the transaction to acquire the asset. Both of them should take the approval. Instead of one approval, it will be two companies' approval. That's it. Notice, seeking approval from shareholders shall clearly provide the particulars of this particular arrangement and the value of the asset calculated by registered valuer. This is very important, friends. Registered valuer, section 247, read with your registered valuer rules, which were notified on 18th October 2017, clearly says that for certain sections where there is a specific emphasis in the act that you have to go to registered valuer, you don't have a compromise or choice. Like section 62(1)(c), when there is a preferential issue, you have to certainly go to a registered valuer. Otherwise, you are violating the provisions of Companies Act. If it is 230 or 236, when you are going for chapter 15 compromise arrangement, then you have to certainly go to a registered valuer. So likewise, for this particular section also, if there is going to be a non-cash transaction involved, there is an arrangement and the value of this particular acquisition shall be backed by the registered valuer's calculation. Why? To ensure that the valuation is in order and you are not taking this particular money which is invested by the shareholder in the interest of the director or person connected with him. This transaction in contravention 192(3) says this is voidable at the option of the company. Means company can make this section, if this transaction, for example, in the illustration which we discussed, company A is acquiring asset from the director of company A without seeking the approval of shareholders or without getting this valuation done, then this particular transaction, company A can jolly well say that it is null and void, which means it is invalid. But there are two exceptions provided under the Act, thankfully, which says that restitution of this particular transaction is possible, which means in this particular illustration, company A is acquiring an asset for, say, 100 rupees. And this particular 100 rupees, that value of the particular asset is already done, and restitution of this particular transaction or consideration is not possible because the money, 100 rupees, already transferred to the seller and company is compensated for its loss. In the given example, 100 is the value and there is a sale made for 80 rupees. The company incurs a loss of 20 rupees. This indemnification of 20 rupees, which is compensation of this loss of 20 rupees, is happening, which means the company cannot invalidate the transaction because they have received what they want. And the restitution, more importantly, what is restitution? Reinstating to its original state is not possible, which means the asset has already lost its original value. Good faith, which is your uberima fidei. Rights are acquired bona fide for value without noticing the contravention. Uberima fidei, we have studied in our Indian Contract Act as well. So in this case, company A is selling an asset to the director for 100 and they're getting the money for 100, and this particular transaction happens, bona fide transaction, without having noticed the fact that 192 is missed out or there is contravention, which means why should I be penalized? Because assuming it in good faith, I have done this transaction. So for these, barring these two exceptions, if there is a transaction which occurs, then the company can certainly say that it is voidable. So it is at the option of the company. CARO reporting comes for 192 compliance. CARO 2016 introduces 192 compliance, friends. Prior to which you never had this 192 reporting. You have this in CARO 2020 also. While we have noticed that there are several amendments in 2020, 192 they have not touched, which means it is retained as is, and those two components of reporting you have to make. What are they? One, you have to say whether the company has entered into any non-cash transaction with the director or person connected with him. If the answer is yes, you please confirm that the company has complied with the provisions of 192, which is fairly simple. It means company should have taken prior approval, valuation they should have obtained from a registered valuer. Fairly simple. If they have not done, then you should not miss out to report that the auditor has provided qualification or given comments for this particular adverse remark in the Cairo report. So if the auditor is unable to express opinion and based on the information and material facts available in hand, if he is not able to ascertain the fact that there is a non-cash transaction, then he can provide necessary caveat in his Cairo report. Facts and reasons shall be disclosed. So what are the transactions which you will be reviewing for this purpose? You will be checking the fixed asset register. You will be checking the MBP1, which is your register of loans and guarantees or security which is provided. You will be checking MBP4, which is your register of contracts or transactions in which the director is interested. After considering all these, along with all the accounting transactions and the journals, if the auditor is unable to express an opinion, then he can certainly disclose the same in his Cairo report. With this, I'm concluding all the three segments, friends. Thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity. And I'll be glad to take your questions before we move on to the next speaker.
Members, if you have any questions, you can raise your questions now. Ma'am, can an Indian company can take an intercorporate deposit from a foreign company?
Yeah.
They can take.
You have to just comply with, because ICD means they talk about only companies. You have to comply with, and also there is this foreign source of fund also provided under 21C exemption list. But you have to comply with the FEMA provision. All the ECB guidelines and other stuff.
Once we comply with the FEMA provisions, we can.
You may do so.
Go ahead. Members, if you are having any questions, you can raise your questions directly.
Or they can, if they would like to ask it later also, I'll be glad to take, Mr. Vamsi. Maybe you can share those questions with me later. Yeah.
Definitely. I think there are no questions, ma'am. So if at all, if I receive any questions later on, I will
forward
it to your questions to you and I will circulate to our members, ma'am.
I'll be glad to take
Thank you very much for your beautiful presentation. On behalf of the Nellore branch and branch members and the management committee, I personally thank you for your beautiful presentation. And also I would like to thank our chief guest, Mr. Jomon K. George for attending the webinar. And also our ex officio member Chinnamasthanai garu for joining us today. And I would like to thank each and every participant who have joined us for the today's webinar and who continuously stayed in the webinar and listened to the program. Thank you very much. And I look forward for your support for the next seminar that we are going to held on 12th. The registration link will be provided to you by today evening. So members can register earliest. If at all, if there are any registration issues, we will try to sort it out a little early so that the issue which we faced in the first meeting will not be repeated. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.